All right, we're going to be in the book of Acts tonight, and we're going to go ahead and we're going to get started, amen? And so this morning what we did was we preached a message. We preached a message on Stephen the Martyr. Amen, those of you that were here, you know what I'm talking about. I titled the message, When Jesus Stood. Amen. Because in the midst of that story, what we saw was that a man named Stephen, who was one of the first deacons that was called in the church because he was a servant, a humble servant. He was filled with the Holy Spirit. He was filled with wisdom. He was filled with the knowledge of God. And he began to contend with the religious people of the time. The truth of the matter is that they didn't understand the scriptures the way that they should have. They could not refute the things that Stephen was saying, and Stephen was filled with the Holy Spirit. And that as time went forward and as the story progressed, what we saw was that the religious leaders came against him. The religious leaders came against him and said it was so bad that they even gnashed on him with their teeth. And I made the point this morning that whenever there's somebody that's caught up in false religion and you begin to try to describe to them and explain to them things that are contrary or not lining up with the scripture, there's only one of two ways that can happen. One of two things that can happen. And listen to me, don't get uncomfortable because the preacher talks loud. I like to talk loud. I'm not mad at anybody in here. I like to tell people that. You know, you want somebody to put you to sleep and you came to the wrong church. I was passionate when I played football. I was passionate when I partied in the world. Come on. And now I'm passionate about Jesus. Amen. And it's okay because I love him. I'm not mad at anybody but the devil. Amen. And what he's doing to people's lives. And so what I want you to know, though, is this. Is that whenever I get passionate and get loud, don't freak out on me. It's going to be all right. But listen, Stephen was over here preaching this message, and the religious people came against him. And what ended up happening was that he died a martyr's death. And that's what that's where we get our word martyr from. In the Greek, it's martyrion, and literally it's the translation of the word witness. And so literally, if you find in the New Testament the word witness, it goes back to the Greek martyrion. And that's where we get our word martyr. Now the word martyr is taken on a completely different context since the New Testament times and even the early church age, because witnesses for Jesus gave their life for the Lord, because in many cases their lives were given. Amen. And so the word took on an added meaning, and Stephen actually was the first martyr. But one of the points that I made to you was that a man that was standing there in the midst of it all, that was consenting unto the death, because the people that killed Stephen laid their clothes at his feet. His name was Saul, and he was a religious leader himself. He didn't know God. He didn't know the ways of God. He knew the Old Testament. He knew the God of the Old Testament. He knew the scriptures from the Old Testament viewpoint, but he didn't know Jesus. You can know a lot of religion, but if you've never truly been born again, come on somebody, I didn't make that up. That's in the Bible, John chapter 3. Jesus told a religious leader in John chapter 3, in case you never heard that story before. Jesus told a religious leader in John chapter 3 that unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God, nor can he enter into the kingdom of God. Jesus, he ends up saying, you know, Nicodemus gets a little confused. He says, how can a man climb a second time into his mother's womb? Jesus said, no. What's born of the flesh is flesh. What's born of the spirit is spirit. You see, according to the scriptures, when mankind is born first in the flesh, he's born in sin like his father Adam. And now Jesus is letting us know that you be born once in the flesh in sin, but you must be born again. Mm-hmm. And the way that you're born again is through faith. Through faith in what? Through faith in what God promised by sending his son to die on the cross to pay the penalty of our sin. And when you hear that message, see, I used to think, this is how I'm telling you, man, that back whenever I used to party, I lived in Lafayette. And one time I was on that little place where all the college kids hang out. They called it the Strip. I told y'all this a while back. I drove by there a while back and I was like, this is what we call the Strip. It was like not really much to it. But anyway, nevertheless, I was standing outside of this little bar called Changes. I don't know what it's called now. It's like a little biker bar. And later on, my friend bought it. And after I had gotten given my heart to Jesus. But we were standing out there, and we were drinking some beer, and we were doing whatever. And I don't remember what happened. I got smart with him. I always used to hang out with people that could beat me up for some reason. But I got smart with him. And whenever I did, he said, "I'll see you in hell, fat boy." That's what he told me. I was a little on the chunky side back then. He said, "I'll see you in hell, fat boy." And I remember I looked at him and said, "Dude, I'm not going to hell." But you know, I thought back about that on multiple occasions. I mean, what made me think I wasn't going to hell? Because I was born a certain religion and that my parents took me to church a couple of Sundays whenever I was a young child, and that since that time I was never faithful to anything. There was no foundation to the statement that I was making. I just felt good. Nope, I'm not going to hell. I won't be there. I thank the Lord that my sister got born again. I thank the Lord that a friend of my sister opened up the Bible and told her. I've told y'all that story too, right? That's a funny story. That's a good one. Come on, let me tell you again. My sister went over to their friend's house, and this was what the deal was. They smoked pot together. And so they invited my sister and her husband over. And what was going to happen was is that the two guys were going to smoke some dope, and then they were going to make fun of my sister. I mean, not my sister, but his wife, because she got religion. And whenever they came over there, what ended up happening was that my sister started venting some frustrations to her about one of her sister-in-laws that was of a particular religion that was coming against her and whatever, and how she was raising her. And all of a sudden, this is what the woman said. I'm just going to tell you what she said. She said, "Did you know that I'm not Catholic anymore?" And my sister said, "What are you talking about? Why not?" She pulled up her open Bible off the shelf, and she put it on the table with a smile on her face, and she said, "I got born again." And my sister said, "What are you talking about?" She said, "Well, let me turn to the scriptures and show you. By the way, I never really read the Bible before. I was never told to read the Bible before. And all of a sudden, one of my friends told me that you must be born again, or else you cannot see the kingdom of God, nor can you enter into the kingdom of God." And all of a sudden, she said, "Let me turn to the scriptures with you." And she turned to John chapter 3, and she said, "This is what the scripture says. Man must be born again." And so listen to me since then. So my sister gave her heart to the Lord. Hallelujah. And listen, whenever I was saying, I'm not done with this story because this is where we're supposed to ride right now. And we might not even get to the rest of the message. But you know what? Whenever the Lord changed my sister's heart, the first thing she did, she came to my house when I was 13 years old, and she started slinging the name of Jesus up in that house. I had never heard her say that name before. What has happened to my sister? I'm telling you, it caused something on the inside of me to get concerned. I thought she had become a fanatic. She literally said the name Jesus in public. What is she doing? You smile, but listen to me. Do you realize, man, I've talked to people in public, and when you say that name, it causes some shaking in the air. Oh, you can talk about everybody else. Go on. You can talk about his mama. You can talk about St. Matthew, St. Malachi, St. Bartholomew, St. whoever got him across the bridge, Christopher. I had him hanging around my neck. You can talk about all these other people, but don't mention the name Jesus in public, because now you're making me feel weird, preacher. Amen. No, hold on a second. He hung naked on a cross. He hung naked on a cross, and he paid the penalty for the sins of man. And is this the truth, or are we just preaching a lie? And if we're not preaching a lie, then we need to get ourselves and understand that the eternal soul hangs in the balance. And she told me about this Jesus. I'm telling you right now, I went to bed that night. I don't know if you believe in the spiritual realm. That's up to you. I went to bed that night and I lied in my bed. And I'm going to tell you something that happened to me. It was a strange occurrence. I said in my heart, I said, "I bet she doesn't even love you, God. I bet she loves the devil." That was a spirit of religion, trying to make me hate what happened to my sister. And when I said that, something spiritual happened to me. Something sat on top of my chest. I couldn't move. I couldn't hear. I couldn't speak. A spirit of fear gripped me. I know what it is now. I'm not going to talk about it now, right now. Now, maybe not tonight's not the time. Maybe on a Thursday night. Something gripped me, and in fear, I was stuck in that bed. I'm here to tell you. Robert will tell you the same thing happened to him after he came back from prison. And all of a sudden, I couldn't do anything. And I just whispered Jesus. I didn't know what else to do. I was trying to scream for my mama. And there wasn't nobody going to hear nothing because something bigger and badder than me had a hold of me. I thought I was tough. I couldn't see it. You can do what you want to. And when I whispered the name Jesus, all of a sudden it broke. And the Lord showed me, you better not mess around with what I've done with your sister. And from that day, I started going to church with her, and I'm telling you, I heard the gospel. And you know what? I heard about Jesus, and I would go up to the altar from time to time. But the fact of the matter is that I never really, really gave my heart to God. And listen, I ended up in 3 rehabs by the age of 19, in detention home multiple times in Lafayette, just constantly trying to numb the pain from my past. And listen to me, every single time I was in one of those places, somebody came in there with a Bible and somebody came in there with the good news to tell me the story about Jesus. I want you to know that man must be born again. And one of the things that my sister said was this. I said, but everybody believes in Jesus. She said, the devils also believe, yet they tremble. That's what the Word of God says in the book of James. The devils also believe, yet they tremble. In other words, I've talked to you about it before, but I'm going to say it again. It's not good enough to have an intellectual understanding that Jesus died on a cross outside the city called Jerusalem. The Word of God says that with the heart man believes unto salvation, and with the mouth he confesses. How do you know when somebody's really giving their heart to Jesus? You and I don't know that. That's only the Holy Spirit's job. But I will tell you this, they'll know it. Because when a man or a woman gives their heart to Jesus for real, something happens. The Word of God says in Ephesians 1:13, you get sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. It means the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of your heart. It means that you can't just keep on, listen to me, I walked in that church that night, I've told you the story before, long hair down my back, smoking dope, drinking, fornicating with every girl I could get my hands on, and that night, I know what's supposed to say that, they got kids in here, and that night when I knelt down at the altar, I woke up something different. You hear me? They don't even know what that word is. We're good. We're clear. Don't you go look it up. We're clear. Anyway, I stood up and I was different. Amen. God changes people's hearts. He's the fixer of the human heart. He changes them. Amen. And I just want you to know that. And listen, Stephen's over here preaching against religion. And Stephen gave his life for the gospel. Stephen gave his life for Jesus. And whenever he did that, it had an impact. It had an effect on the people that were around him. And there were 2 people that I really wanted to talk to you real quick tonight about that I know that it directly impacted their lives. One of them was Saul, who was standing there, who became the Apostle Paul. And the other one was one of the other deacons named Philip. And what I wanted you to know is that first off, in Acts chapter 8, after Stephen has died, this is now in Acts chapter 8, verse 26. All of a sudden, Stephen has died, and the Holy Spirit, or the angel of the Lord, in verse 26, tells Philip, he says, arise and go toward the south unto the way that goes down to Jerusalem and Gaza, which is desert. And he arose and he went, behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority, under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure and had come to Jerusalem for to worship. So this is an interesting occurrence. Philip is told by the angel of the Lord that he needs to go and to go to the specific place, and that there's now an Ethiopian eunuch. All right, well, we won't get into all the gory details of what that means, but essentially it means that they become emasculated. All right? And so with that, and it was for a purpose, because many times these eunuchs were used to work for in the midst of a king's harem and in charge of all of the women that was in his harem. And so therefore, he had to be able to be trusted like that. But not only that, they also many times rose to great heights as far as for taking care of the financial situation for these kings or these queens. And this particular eunuch, that's exactly what he does. He takes care of the finances for this queen, Candace. I did a little bit of research. This Ethiopia was actually an extension of the area of Egypt. So the king would have been one who was worshipped as the sun god Ra, and he doesn't have time to worry about the kingdom business. And so she's really the one that's in charge. And this Ethiopian eunuch is the one that's actually the servant, that's basically the number cruncher for all of her kingdom. And what we see here, though, is this. He's not a Jew by birth. He's not a Jew by birth. He's from this area that's lower, but yet he has taken the time to go to Jerusalem to worship the Lord. And the Word of God says right here that he was returning and he was sitting in his chariot and he was reading Isaiah the prophet. Now, I'm not going to go to all the scriptures, but I did want to turn to one. I thought it was interesting when I found this, that in Isaiah chapter 56, because you see, eunuchs were not allowed to go to the house of God. According to the Old Testament law, it was like they were a desecrate. The animals in the Old Testament had to be pure and without blemish whenever they were offered up as a sacrifice. And because these eunuchs were considered that there was something wrong with their body, they weren't allowed to go. It wasn't that they couldn't serve God. It wasn't that they couldn't inherit eternal life. But the reality of it was is that they were not allowed in the house of God. But there was a promise in the book of Isaiah, and I believe this speaks of the millennial reign of Christ. It says right here in Isaiah chapter 56, verse 4, "For thus says the Lord unto the eunuchs that keep my Sabbaths, and choose the things that please me, and take hold of my covenant. Even unto them will I give in my house and within my walls a place and a name better than of sons and of daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off." You see, here we have a story where Stephen is full of the Holy Spirit and he begins to witness the things of God. Just as that woman was full of the Holy Spirit and witnessed to my sister, and my sister witnessed to me, Stephen witnessed and he did the work, amen. And now Philip is going and he's talking to this Ethiopian eunuch. But what I want you to understand is that this Ethiopian eunuch had already understood that there was a God in Israel and that there was a place in his word that had a special hope and a special place for a eunuch. Now, I don't know what it's like to be a eunuch, but I would imagine that once this has happened to you, whether it's been as a child, whether it was when you were a little bit older, whenever it may have happened, it definitely has changed your life. You understand what I'm saying? We think that we got some problems, but the reality of it is that many times people are born with certain conditions, they're born in certain situations, or things happen to them in the course of life, and they have to live with that thing. It's easy for you and I just to go on with our daily life and go about our business, but these people are living every single day with these things that are going on in their life. And I can't even imagine how he must have felt. And somehow, some way, he heard that the God of the Jews, in one of the books of the prophets, had a special place in his heart for eunuchs that would keep the Sabbath. And somehow he started reading the word, and somehow he started deciding that he was going to go to Jerusalem, and that he was going to worship the God of the Jews. And yet, here we find a situation that is almost like the Samaritan woman. Do you remember the story of the Samaritan woman? She was by the well. And the word of God says that Jesus must needs go through Samaria. What that means in the original language is that the Holy Spirit compelled Jesus to go through Samaria. I don't have time to break down why he wouldn't have gone through Samaria, but Jews didn't walk through Samaria. They went all the way around. They crossed over the Jordan River, and they walked to the right of the Jordan River, and they passed up Samaria, and then they walked back over here again, and they came back around just so they wouldn't have to walk in the land of the Samaritans. Because they hated each other. They thought they were unclean. They thought that they were dirty. But the Holy Spirit told Jesus he must needs go through Samaria, compelled him to go. And when he gets there, we understand why. He goes to the well to get a drink of water, and there's that woman, and she's lonely, and she's broken, and she's over here, and her life has been in shambles. And Jesus ends up telling her at one point, "Go get your husband." She said, "I don't have a husband." He said, "This you say is true. You've already had five, and the one that you're living with now is not your husband." What I'm trying to tell you is that she was in pain. This Ethiopian eunuch is in pain. And yet the Holy Spirit compels Philip and tells him, go down there. And when he goes down there, he sees the purpose for why he was going. He sees this Ethiopian eunuch sitting in this chariot. He's got the scroll open to Isaiah. Maybe he was reading about eunuchs. I don't really know. He's got the scroll open to Isaiah. And Philip comes up to, it says verse 29, "Then the Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join yourself to this chariot." Don't you like it when the Holy Spirit tells you stuff? Amen. When he puts it on your heart, give somebody a Bible, give somebody a tract, tell somebody about Jesus. When he opens up the door and he uses you in that way, amen. Holy Spirit told Philip, go and connect yourself to this chariot. And Philip ran over there to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah, is what it says in the King James, and that means Isaiah. And said, understandest thou what you read? That's Philip's question. Do you understand what you're reading? And he said, how can I except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and he would sit with him. So here's this man. I don't know, man. I was reading about it earlier and my heart kind of just got touched. He's over here going to Jerusalem and trying to do, he can't go into the house of God, but yet he makes the pilgrimage anyway just to be in the city of God. The city that means peace. We've been studying that. The place where peace abounds because the presence of God lives there. Why? Because there's a temple, and behind the veil of the temple there's a mercy seat. There's an ark, and in the ark is the tablets, the Ten Commandments, the testimony. Like we talked about this morning, the tabernacle of witness. The word of God that proves that God's presence was with Israel. And this eunuch has made this trip just to be in the city of God. And he reads the scriptures, but he doesn't understand them. He doesn't understand what he's really reading. And here God sends Philip. I don't know if God's ever sent somebody your way before. I don't know if God's ever sent somebody your way before to help you to better understand the scriptures. I know he sent people my way. See, I want to encourage you. If true disciples are going to be made, then you and I got to get into the Word. Because I can't go meet with every person that you know. I can't. It's our job, amen, as the children of God. I've only been a pastor for 4 months. I've been studying the Word of God a lot longer than that. Amen, but I'm not tooting my horn. I'm trying to make a point. I've been studying the Word of God for a long time. I've been witnessing the Word of God for a long time. I've desired to be a witness for Jesus, amen, for a long time. Because I want to tell people the good news about what God has done in my life. And the truth of the matter is that it's all of our jobs to study, to show ourselves approved. A workman that rightly divides the word of truth shall not be ashamed, amen. It's important for you and I to get into the scriptures because we never know when the Holy Spirit's going to say, go over here, connect yourself to this chariot, and you're going to find out that the man's going to say, how can I understand it unless somebody helps me? And all of a sudden it says right here, Philip, that he would come up and sit with him. Verse 32, the place of the scripture which he read was this, he was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shearer, so opened he not his mouth. Now I want you to know that Isaiah prophesied this about 600 years before the birth of Jesus. Isaiah the prophet explains, amen, that he would be led, talking about Jesus, as a lamb is led to the slaughter, and like a lamb he would be dumb, meaning he would not speak. That's what it means to be dumb, dumb or mute. He would not speak. Jesus was led, and the only time he ever opened his mouth is whenever they asked him a direct question. He didn't try to take his own defense. He willingly went to the sacrifice. The Father had revealed to him in the Garden of Gethsemane what the will of the Father was. There was no turning back now. And it says, and before his shearer, so opened he not his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. And who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. I just want you to know that when you start talking about Jesus, something starts happening. Earlier today, when we talked about Philip, we also talked about Peter a little bit before that. And when Peter preached his first message, the Word of God says that the people's heart was pricked. It hit them in the heart. Spiritually speaking, they were hit in the heart, and the response was, they said this, what must we do to be saved? Peter said, you must repent. And you must be baptized in the name of Jesus. But Stephen starts preaching, and it says that their hearts were sawn asunder. And instead of wanting to know what they needed to do to be saved, they stuck their fingers in their ears. Remember that? And they started crying. Ah! No, I don't want to hear it. Stop it. Stop preaching, preacher. I don't want to hear it anymore. You're messing up my life. And then the next thing you know, they grabbed a hold of him and they killed him. See, the same gospel will do one of two things to you. It'll either soften your heart towards the things of God or it'll harden your heart. The same sun that softens butter hardens clay. And the same gospel that softens one hardens another. And listen to me, if you keep on, and that's what the Word of God says, Romans chapter 1, verse 16. The Apostle Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to them which believe. And he goes on to say that the wrath of God is poured out upon man when they suppress the truth. When you hear the truth of God and you suppress the truth, the wrath of God gets poured out on you.
Yes.
You can't suppress the truth about Jesus. You can't suppress the truth that He is the darling of heaven and that He died on the cross for you. You can't suppress the fact that He wants to live in your heart and minister to you. And if you do, then it'll have a negative effect in your life. He goes on to say right here, and the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speaks the prophet? The reason I just said all that is because when you start talking Jesus, it has an effect on the people that you're talking to. You might not be able to see it in their eyes. You might not be able to hear their heartbeat increase. But I'm here to tell you that if you start speaking Jesus and believe that God's going to use you, something starts happening. And whenever he's talking about the word of God, this eunuch and wants to know, who is this prophet talking about? Is he talking about himself or some other man? And Philip opened his mouth and he began at the same scripture and he preached unto him Jesus. Hallelujah. Isn't that nice? Isn't that nice to see a man of God so well versed in the scripture that he just happens upon a chariot and some guy's got a scroll open and he's got it open to Isaiah chapter 53 and he's reading, hey, do you know what he's talking about? How can I unless somebody teaches me? And Philip's like, well, I'm just the guy for the job. I've been studying that. Let me help you out, brother. This is talking about Jesus. 600 years before he ever showed up on the earth. Now, you better pay attention. You better pay attention. The prophet prophesied it 600 years before Jesus ever became flesh. And he said that he was going to be led like a lamb to slaughter. And that he was going to die for the sins of mankind. He was going to bear our iniquities upon him. And so the prophet, as the eunuch turns around in verse 36, he says, as they went on their way, they came into a certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What does hinder me to be baptized? See, that's an adult baptism right there. That's a perfect example. I wasn't even thinking about that in regard to dedication, but there it is. An adult was baptized that day. And the reason he was baptized is because, once again, the first time you're born like your father Adam. You're born broken and dead. And you're not happy. You can say you are, but you're not. Because everything that you try to fill up in your little Jesus spot in your heart, it never really works. It keeps you empty, and it keeps you sad, and you keep looking for that piece to the puzzle. But there's only one thing that fits in there. His name is Jesus. Because this whole thing that we're walking through on this earth is not so that we can have a better job. It's not so that I can go through life and keep on getting degrees and I got my master's degree now. Now I'm a nurse practitioner. It's not so that I can, no, it's not so I can make more money. It's not so I can drive a BMW. It's not so I can live in a bigger house. It's not so that, I'm going to stop right there. But this is the point. You keep trying to put something in that spot that only Jesus belongs in and it leaves you empty. And Christians can do the same thing too. And whenever you were born like your father Adam, born in sin, but when you got born again, the Word of God says that you were baptized into Jesus. This is Jesus. You were baptized into Him. Now this is a spiritual baptism. The Holy Spirit took you. You were born of Adam, born in sin. The Holy Spirit took you and He translated you. He put you in Jesus. He put you in Jesus and you were baptized into His death. You were baptized into His burial. Rest in peace, Adam. And you were resurrected to newness of life. You were resurrected in Jesus. You became born again. You became a new creation in Christ. And now water symbolizes this. The old man born of Adam puts his faith in Jesus. The old man born of Adam goes under the water. He's buried under the water. The new man in Christ comes up a new creation. That's why adults are baptized in the scripture and not babies. And what I want you to know is that this eunuch understood that. And he understood enough to know that water baptism meant something because he had heard and seen what was going on in Christianity and what was taking place. And Philip taught him about the scriptures and began to preach to him Jesus. And at some point in time, this eunuch received the Lord as his Savior. And he said, look, here's the water. What hinders me to be baptized. And Philip said, if you believe with all your heart. See right there? You can't just believe with your head. Listen to me. This is real important stuff right here. This may have something to do with your family members. You cannot believe just with your head. We're not talking about intellectual knowledge. You have to believe with your heart. If you believe with your heart, it says right here, you mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. I want to turn real quick to Acts chapter 17. That's one person that was affected, I believe, by Stephen's ministry and Stephen's death. He was led by the Holy Spirit to light upon. He was willing to be a humble servant. He listened to God, and he went, and he had an impact in this man's life. And you know, we don't know, but the Lord is the only one that knows how many people that this man could have affected at the petition that he had. Amen. Bless you. Now we're talking about the Apostle Paul. And he shows up in Greece. See, remember, Paul was, his first name was Saul. And if you'll remember this morning, where we left off in our story was that Saul was standing there and he was giving consent for them to be able to stone Stephen. Remember that?
Yeah.
And it says that in the next verse, chapter 8, verse 1, it says that, well, as a matter of fact, I'm just going to turn there right here. And Saul was consenting unto his death. And at that time, this is Acts chapter 8, verse 1, but you don't have to stress. I'm reading it for you. Okay?
Okay.
All right. And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. And look at this. As for Saul, see, this is another thing that happens. Once again, he heard the gospel and he was consenting unto Stephen's death, and he refused the gospel, and his heart got even harder. And at some point in time, you get so hard that you get turned over to the devil.
Amen.
But nevertheless, God was merciful with Paul. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house and hailing men and women, committed them to prison. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. It goes on to say that the story goes, and I know I've told y'all this story many times because it's one of my favorite ones, that not long after this, I think it's in chapter 9, Saul goes to Damascus, which is up above Syria. Well, it's actually, I believe, the capital of Syria. He goes to Damascus to get letters to throw Christians in prison and to have them killed. He's so angry. Oh, he loved it whenever Stephen was getting stoned. He said, yeah, throw another rock on him. Throw one for me. I hate the way that these Christians are trying to take over. And he's on his way to go get these letters from Damascus. And all of a sudden, the Bible says, a bright light shone from above and blinded him and knocked him down. Knocked him down on the ground, and a voice from heaven began to speak to him and said, Saul, Saul, why do you kick against the pricks? Why do you, another word is a goad. And I've told you all about that many times. It's like a sharpened stick. And they would use it to poke animals in their hindquarters to make them go before they had electric prods. Poke them real hard in their hindquarters to make them go in the right direction. God was telling Saul, I've been poking you in your hindquarters, but you're not listening to me. You keep raring against me. You're kicking. You're trying to get it off of your backside. And I'm trying to get you to go a certain direction, but you refuse. And so now I've knocked you down, and I got your attention. I'm going to blind you for a little bit. I'm going to slow you down. I'm going to make you stay right here, and I got to tell you something. Saul says, who are you, Lord? He said, I'm Jesus. I'm the one that you're persecuting. This is the resurrected, ascended Savior that has taken the time to speak to the Apostle Paul, the future Apostle Paul's heart, after he just watched Stephen get stoned and everybody laid their clothes down at his feet. And here he is on the road to Damascus, falling down, blinded, and the voice of the very Jesus that died on the cross is sitting here speaking to him. And God would send someone else to minister to him and to tell him the things of God. And the next thing you know, the Bible says, scales fell from his eyes. He was filled with the Holy Spirit. And immediately he went and preached Jesus in the synagogues. I'm telling you, the Apostle Paul was a mighty man of God. In this story that I'm about to read to you and talk to you about, just about a week ago, he was in Philippi. He was in Philippi walking down, and I know we've already talked about this story. I don't apologize for continuing to talk about the story. We got three services a week. We get to talk about the Bible. And there was a damsel, and she was vexed with the spirit of divination, meaning that she could tell you your future. It's kind of like Sister Chloe or whatever that you call up. You know, whatever that lady used to be. Palm reader. That was her name, Miss Chloe or something. And they had a spirit of divination. And she made her masters great money because she would tell them their story. And the way that she did that was through the use of demon spirits. You don't have to believe in the spiritual realm if you don't want to. It's okay. She would use... No, you really need to, but I'm just telling you, if it freaks you out, just act like I didn't say it. She would use demon spirits to give her information in order to speak about these people's lives. And then people would give her money for it. And all of a sudden, the crazy thing is this. You know what it gets me about this story is that she's walking behind Paul and Silas. And she says, these men are from God. They give us the beautiful words of God. She's actually telling the truth. But she's operating under another spirit. See, you can't believe everything that you hear. Everything that calls itself Christian isn't Christian. And here she is operating under another spirit, and Paul turns around and he rebukes the spirit, and all of a sudden the spirit comes out and she can't do what she's supposed to do anymore. Well, that causes a problem because the rich people owned her and now they're not making any money off of her. And it touched his pockets. And the next thing you know, he goes and he has Paul thrown in prison, and they beat him. They beat Paul and Silas. They leave their, they cause the lashes upon their back, and their back's just full of meat, and it's over, it's a bloody mess. And they're in the stockade, so they've been beaten. I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel real convicted whenever I read about the Apostle Paul's life. Whenever I start feeling bad about what I go through, the little bit of persecution I face, because people laugh at me sometimes. He's in the stockade, and his back's been beaten. And all of a sudden, I think he probably looked over there at Silas and he said, are we going to sit here and try to stay depressed? Are we going to sit here and try to stay depressed, or are we going to start singing to the Lord? And they start singing to the Lord. And the next thing you know, the earth begins to quake, everything shakes, the jail cell opens up, and the Philippian jailer is about to kill himself. Because he said, listen, man, if the Roman centurion finds out that I lost these prisoners, oh Lord, help me. But Paul screams out, no, don't kill yourself. We haven't left. And the next thing you know, that Philippian jailer got saved. What I want you to know is that was just about a week or two before this right here. So Paul still got some deep wounds in his back. He's not slowing down. Probably rubbed a little salt on there. A little disinfectant. Kind of shoved some salt in there. Make sure it doesn't get infected. But we got a job to do. We got a job to do because this story is real. And if you don't get a hold of it, and you don't let Jesus in your heart, and you don't repent of your sins, you're going to find yourself burning in the devil's hell. Paul believed it. And here he is. It shows up right here in verse 17 of Acts chapter 17. He went to the synagogue, and he began to dispute with the Jews. There it is again. He saw Stephen doing it, so he figured that was the right thing to do. Right? Stephen was disputing with the religious folk. So here, the Apostle Paul does the same thing. He would go to the synagogue. I love this right here. This is the first time I ever really saw this clearly. He would go to the synagogue and he would dispute with the Jews. And then he would also go with devout persons. That was people that already knew the Lord. So he'd go talk to them about Jesus. And then he would go to the marketplace every day. And he would talk to whoever would listen to him over there. So to me, I'm seeing for the first time the Apostle Paul's just looking for anybody he can talk to about Jesus. He's willing to go talk to religious people that aren't going to like what he has to say. He's willing to talk to Christians that love Jesus, and we can have fellowship and communion with one another as we talk about the Lord. And he's also ready to go meet, amen, with people in the marketplace that don't know anything about the things of God. Anybody that's willing to listen, I'm willing to tell you about Jesus. And then it says that certain philosophers... Epicureans, they believed basically that the soul was annihilated at death. In other words, you don't have anything to worry about. You live your life today, you get it while the getting's good. The motto of Aleister Crowley, do what thou wilt and let that be the whole of the law. Don't let anybody restrain you. Don't let anybody hold you back. Just go get it. Get whatever you want to get. Because whenever this life is over, just like your body's going to decay in the grave, so will your soul. That's a lie. Your soul is your individuality. It's connected to your spirit. Your spirit is an eternal being, and you will spend eternity somewhere. If no preacher ever told you that, he's a bad preacher. You need to hear that. You will spend eternity somewhere. And if you didn't receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it won't be the place that you wanted to go, I can assure you. It goes on to say this. It says, not only the Epicureans, but the Stoics. Now, they were kind of like modern-day New Age. They believed that whenever you die, everybody's spirit, in other words, everything is part of, everything is God. Yes, God's the creator of everything, but God's not everything. We're not God. Grass isn't God. Amen? But they believe everything's God, and whenever you die, your spirit just becomes part of a big old spirit. That's the lie of New Age. And so these are the kinds of people and certain philosophers that Paul is dealing with as he's over here in Greece. And he's been talking to the synagogue. He's been talking to people in the market. And look what it says right here. It says, when they encountered him, some said, what will this babbler say? So they heard him speaking some of the words, and they called him a babbler. Now, I thought this was interesting. I looked this word up. And the word in the Greek is spermologos. And it means seed, words of seed. But the idea has to do with like a pigeon in the marketplace would pick up a seed with his mouth and bring it over here and then drop it over here. And he'd pick up a seed over here and he'd drop it over here. Basically what they were trying to say was that Paul was just a regurgitator of words. He heard somebody else say something, and so now he's just regurgitating what he heard somebody else say. In other words, he didn't have anything fresh. He didn't have anything new. You know what's sad is that kind of stuff's going on in the church today. As a matter of fact, there's a church not too far from here that I was talking to somebody the other day. I was talking to somebody the other day, and they shared with me that somebody in the music ministry told them that he was Googling online or in some kind of chat room, and all of these same churches had preached the same message with the same title. And they all shared a message that they got from some other dude that wrote it, like, I don't know where he was from, Cali or some cool place like that. So he wrote his sermon, and he puts it online, and all of these people preach the same message with the same title and the same verses in it. And he's talking to my friend, and he says, did you know that people do that? He said, man, that disturbs me. People are over there sharing everybody's sermon, and nobody's digging in the Word of God for themselves. That disturbs me, man. And so what he did was he went back and he talked to the son of one of these pastors. He says, hey man, did you know that people share each other's sermons like that? And the guy's like, well, my daddy gets his stuff from a guy in Florida. He's like, what? What are you talking about? He said, man, why should my dad have to do all that work whenever somebody's already done all that groundwork for him? What are you talking? What's the problem? And this is the situation. People are regurgitating the words of other men. And I'm not saying that we don't ever read or learn from other people. But what I'm saying is that you need the Holy Spirit to speak to you and to reveal the Word of God to you and to study the Scriptures so that you can communicate them to the people of God. And that's what they think about Paul. They think about Paul that he's some seed picker. He's a babbler. He's just regurgitating the words of men. They don't know that last week he was in Philippi and got his back ripped to shreds. They don't know that not that long ago he stood there and he watched Stephen stoned to death. And they don't know that he was on the road to Damascus and a light shined and knocked him down to the ground and the voice of God spoke to him and changed his heart. No, he heard straight from God. And he's got a word for them. I'm going to hurry up because you know what? I think I've taken a lot of your time. But what ends up happening is he begins to reason with them. And he begins to preach to them about the resurrection. And the truth of the matter is that he was walking around the city. They brought him to a place called Mars Hill. It's still there. It's a hill that's really natural marble. And they say when it rains, it's slippery. You got to be careful when you walk up the stairs. That's where the council in Athens, Greece was. And not only that, philosophers would stand there. And what they would do is they would stand up there with all of their philosophy and all of their intellect, and they would begin to spew out all of the knowledge that they had. And they brought Paul over there because they heard a little bit of what they were calling the babbling, the seed picking, and they wanted him to stand up there and to go ahead and speak what it was that he thought that he knew something about. They heard him say something about the resurrection. They said, this seems like some kind of new something that we want to hear. And so he gets up there and he begins to stand. He says, you know, I find that you're a very superstitious people. See, because as I've been walking down, up and down in your streets, I see all of these idols that you have. Graven images. The Word of God says in the book of Exodus, you're not supposed to have graven images. The Word of God says time and time again, it's not supposed to be a graven image of a man, a beast, a bird, a four-footed thing. You're not supposed to have statues. Why? Because in the land of Canaan, before God brought them into the promised land, they had, you'll have to look the word up, I don't have time to go there, they had Nephilim in the land, that they had wickedness in the land, they were polluting the land, they were engaging in sorcery, they were making graven images, they were making statues, they were worshiping statues. Why? Because that's how the demons take worship away from God, is that they entice mankind to make statues. The word of the Lord said, don't make a graven image. But yet, here in Athens, that's all they have. Graven images everywhere Paul goes. He's disturbed in his heart and in his spirit. So many of them that they even had one that was called the unknown God. Paul said, that's the one I want to talk to you about. The unknown God. You're so superstitious. And this is the word superstitious was interesting in the Greek also. It has the word demonion connected to it, which is where we get our word demon. That word that's translated in the English as superstitious has the word demon connected to it. And the idea behind the word is that they try to serve in a religion, but they're driven by fear and not trust. And that's what demons do. They cause mankind to worship some false statue or something like that. There's no peace connected to it. Whenever you worship the things of the world, there's no peace connected to it. And instead of trust, it's only fear that tries to drive people in order to get their get out of hell free card. Paul said, I find you're a very superstitious people. You even have a statue to one called the unknown God. He's the one that I want to talk to you about. I want to tell you that he created the heavens and the earth. This is what drew me to this text, though. Paul took a line out of Stephen's message. It touched my heart, man. I never realized that before, Rob. That Stephen had such a huge impact on the Apostle Paul's life. I mean, I knew it, but now I know it. Do you know that people are watching? Do you know what kind of impact you can have in people's lives? And here the Apostle Paul says, don't you know that this God I'm talking about doesn't live in temples, doesn't dwell in temples that are made with man's hands? And that's the same line that Stephen had preached, and I just feel in my heart that it rung in Paul's ears. And he thought to himself, what a mighty preacher, what a mighty man of God. And how many times did Paul use that line in his preaching? I don't know. But he told him, he said, listen to me. He goes on to say, in the past, verse 30 right here, verse 30 of chapter 17. And in times past of this ignorance, God winked. Talking about all these. No, I'm sorry, let's go up a little higher. Let's go to verse 27. That they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. You know, the presence of God is just right there. Somebody came to church this morning, and they hadn't been to church in a while. And they didn't share this with me. They shared it with somebody else. Started basically confessing everything that they had been in. And I'm telling you, this person's been in a mess. And what this person said was this. I was so far away, and I've been so far away so many times. And God's been so merciful to me. And I've made so many mistakes. And he said, you know what the crazy thing is? All I had to do was fall to my knees. I finally got to a place again where I fell to my knees. And I said, Jesus, I need you. And whenever he did that, he said it changed. He said everything changed. Now I hope he stays on his knees. And Lord, help me to stay on my knees. Amen. But the truth of the matter is that God is merciful and he's gracious and he's just waiting for somebody to fall to their knees. Amen. What I wanted you to know is that what Paul was saying was this. He's not far from any of us. He's just one whisper away. If you've never received the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I'm going to give you a chance tonight. But even if you don't do it tonight, you need to remember, whether you're traveling on the highway, whether you're flying in a plane, wherever you are back at your home, wherever that is, wherever you go, wherever you wander, He's just one whisper away. All you got to do is whisper the name Jesus. And if you mean it in your heart, I'm telling you right now, everything will change. He'll come to live on the inside. He'll show you where you need to go. He'll show you what you need to do. He'll transform your life. If you feel there's an empty spot, you need to understand, He wants to fill it. He's been working His plan for thousands of years. He's not going to change it. Goes on to say in verse 28, "For in Him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also His offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's device." You can't carve God out of a rock. "And the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent." It means in times past, people were making statues and God kind of let them go ahead and have their way. But now, now the manifestation is here. Jesus has showed up, the answer for man's sin. God's not winking at anything anymore. He's demanding that people hear this gospel, and He's demanding that people respond to it one way or the other. "Because He has appointed a day in which He will judge the world in righteousness by that man," talking about Jesus, "whom He has ordained, whereof He has given assurance unto all men, and that He has raised Him from the dead." Oh, hallelujah. The Father raised Jesus from the dead. There was no sin in Him, and there was no right for death to hold Him down. Amen. "And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked and others said, we will hear thee again of this matter. So Paul departed from them. Howbeit certain men clave unto Him." I like that word. When I looked it up, it said to stick like glue. That's what it literally said, glue. They stuck themselves to Paul like glue. "Are you not leaving? You're not getting away from me. And this Jesus you preached, He already changed my life. I got to hear more of this. I'm going to follow you around. I'm going to follow you around everywhere you go, because I got to hear more about this Jesus." Amen?
Amen.
It goes on to say, "among the which was Dionysius, the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them."